Frank Zappa was an American composer, guitarist, and tobacco enthusiast, notorious for his work with controversial counterculture circus act, the Mothers of Invention. Spurred into action by 20th century classical music, rhythm and blues, and doo-wop, Zappa is well known for having worked across a multitude of styles with a multitude of musicians, many of them hugely successful in their own right. During a foray into what could be described broadly as jazz fusion, some of these musicians would include piano player George Duke, violin player Jean-Luc Ponty, and Family Guy drummer Ralph Humphrey, with whom Zappa toured between 1973 and 1974, with three iterations of what enthusiasts dubbed the Roxy Band, so named due to their feature on the album Roxy and Elsewhere. Each version of the band would play the song I am analysing in this video, RDNZL. I'm going to be focusing on the version from Roxy by Proxy, but will also reference an earlier arrangement from the same year. RDNZL is a brisk piece based on two basic melodic themes interpolated with solos. The most interesting thing about it is the way that Zappa handles rhythm. The piece's central rhythmic idea is a metric modulation between 12/8 and 4/4 time. Harmony in this piece is non-functional. Zappa uses extended chords for colour, but the piece's handling of tonality is defined by frequent modulations of simple chords and phrases. Being modal, the piece is quite close to rock in terms of its harmonic identity, as it seems less concerned with the intricacies of diatonic harmony than most jazz, but it distances itself significantly from that genre with the frequent and unusual ways in which Zappa moves around different tonal centres. The very first statement the piece makes is a two-bar introduction. It is a 12/8 vamp based around a D add 4 chord, with vibraphone flourishes outlining G suspended 2nd, an inversion of D suspended 4th, arpeggios, displaced by octaves. This establishes a tonal centre and some of the primary rhythmic materials, with the vibraphone flourishes functioning to keep the vamp from sounding static. Tonality is mixolydian, indicated by the flat 7 chord featured in the keyboard accompaniment. The main statement of the first theme follows this. This consists of four pairs of call and response phrases, each pair lasting one bar. The melody utilizes duplets, creating a 2-against-3 polyrhythm. Harmony is triadic and the motion is driven by 4/3 suspensions. It makes use of chromatic medians, transposing each phrase up a major third from the last. Each second phrase of every second pair prepares the subsequent phrase by transforming the previous chord by a half step. No clear tonal centre is retained due to the frequent modulations. This next section was originally used as a vamp for solos, but it was later given a fixed melody, which can be heard in You Can't Do That On Stage Anymore, Volume 2. I'm not going to focus on this melody as it isn't present in the version that I'm analysing. However, bootlegs reveal that it was in fact present in an intermediary version between this version and the finalised version, which was played much more frequently through 1974 onwards. The beginning of this features syncopated stabs based on a newly tonicized C. These stabs last for two bars, the first of which simply uses the tonic chord, but the second of which places the 7 chord over the tonic, so in this first instance, this would be B-flat major over C. The stabs in the first bar move around the beat, only explicitly stating the downbeat twice. This briefly disorienting choice emphasizes the subsequent unambiguous 12/8 ostinato through contrast. Each iteration of the vamp modulates down a major second from the key of the preceding stabs. Each phrase is two bars in length, placing a flat 7 card over the tonic in the first bar, which resolves to the 1 card in the second bar. From the stabs up until the modulation is what I am regarding as one unit. Upon completion of each unit, which is every 4 bars, the tonal centre moves up a major third, with one exception. The fourth and final iteration of this phrase is modulated down a major second, and remains on a C triad for 2 bars. The syncopations in the first bar are also slightly different to the syncopations previously featured. This allows the tonicization of C to be emphasized, serving to ensure the starkness of the move to an F-sharp major 7 chord, a tritone away from the C. The end of this section is punctuated by accented syncopated stabs built on a quartal F-sharp chord, which distinguishes itself from the entirely triadic harmonies that have been used up until this point. A unison melody is constructed from chord tones. The addition of a D-sharp suggests an F-sharp major tonality, and this segues into the next section. This section is just a vamp based on the tonic of A Lydian. This is invariably used as a backdrop for a guitar solo. It marks the first metric modulation. This section moves from 12/8 to 4/4, which is notated as a dotted eighth note equals quarter note. This continues until Zappa ends his solo and signals a transition into the secondary theme. This section is in 3/4 time, and it distinguishes itself by being the only occurrence of triple meter in this piece. The harmony differs between versions. Earlier versions use an F as the root, accompanied by an F6 chord, suggesting the tonality might be F Lydian due to the B natural in the melody. Later versions, however, use a D as the root, suggesting a Dorian tonality instead. The melody relies on triads from the key, outlining a G major triad, C major triad, A minor triad, G major triad, and E minor triad, in that order with some passing notes. As such, all of the melodic writing here is either in thirds or stepwise. Outlining these chords facilitates a sense of motion over the static harmonies. The second phrase modulates to an E-flat Dorian tonality with no preparation. Whether this line was Dorian or Mixolydian would be ambiguous, as the accompanying chord is an E-flat sus2, but the presence of a G-flat in the harmony confirms that it is Dorian. The final phrase modulates up a half-step to E Dorian. The melody is conjunct, only moving in seconds after an initial leap of the fourth. The melody comprises of call and response phrases, both on the larger and smaller scales. The sense of phrasing over the static harmonies is achieved by careful use of contour and specific use of intervallic leaps. For example, the open fifths, the largest melodic interval so far, which signals the conclusion of this phrase and the segue into the next. The melody in this section is harmonized mainly by using thirds and fourths. Momentum is built by the occasional use of a major second, although the lines always resolve on chord tones. Following the secondary theme is an interlude which, aside from the return to 12/8 time, is a complete departure from the previously established material. It culminates in short, aleatoric bursts of gesture while retaining the beat. It seems to function almost as comic relief. This is typically a solo spot for pianist George Duke. It consists of 4-bar phrases. The first 2 bars are occupied by a 1-5 cadence. The second 2 bars modulate down a step and answer the previous phrase with a 5-1 cadence. This changes after 12 bars, whereupon the 2 bars of 1-5 are answered with a bar of flat 5 of 5, which segues into the syncopated quartal stabs from section A, signalling the return to head. As with section A, every 4 bars the parts modulate up a major third from the last chord. Zouk plays rootless voicings in his left hand, favouring stepwise motion between the chords' individual voices. In terms of chord quality, Zouk favours major sevenths, minor sevenths, and dominant sevenths. The bass line just walks through the chords, interpolating chord tones with chromatic passing notes. Standard walking bass line stuff. Structurally, this section could be considered to mark a return to head, substituting section A and setting up the variations of the rest of the themes. In place of the guitar solo is an A major 7 chord, sustained by the keys and winds. The bass arpeggiates this chord in various ways, including the 6th amongst its chord tones, and it gradually opens up the range between the highest and lowest notes. This is accompanied by marimba run, which superimposes a B major pentatonic scale over the A major 7. This works because the scale shares all of its notes with A major 7, including the D sharp, which would be the sharp 4, as this alludes to the Lydian tonality of the guitar solo earlier in the piece. This was sometimes accompanied by a very brief clarinet solo, but once Ian Underwood left the band, nobody picked up the torch. Following this is a variation of the secondary theme, stated this time in 12-8. The phrase is stated over half of the bar, then is answered with a drum fill over the other half. An F pedal is used and is played in unison with the melody. The second half switches to 4-4 and relies on a rock groove, but there are no other significant changes. The marimba uses a tremolando effect between 2 octaves to reinforce the texture, supporting the middle to upper ranges of pitch. The 12-8 marimba fill is based in C-sharp Dorian, making use of familiar triadic and suspended second gestures. It is suspended over a C-sharp sus2 chord. The line alternates 2 arcs, a downward arc and an upward arc. The range peaks 3/4 of the way into the bar before it dips to prepare for a repetition. Finally, we have the coda. This is all more or less identical to the introduction, only all of the notes' durations have been doubled, a form of a process called augmentation. The drums play an extended fill throughout this entire section, maintaining the momentum by occupying the space between the notes of the newly augmented melody. I especially love how Ralph Humphrey handles this in early 1973 versions, such as the one featured on the Lost Episodes album. The piece ends with an elongated C major with the B flat in the bass, which the marimba arpeggiates before settling on a tremolando effect between the 5th and 3rd degrees. Zappa's use of the 7th in the bass is possibly an attempt to slightly destabilize the chord. This helps to produce a real sense of resolution, whilst also giving the climax a sense of drama by giving the listener one final surprise, as Zappa described adding special articulations and colours as putting the eyebrows on a piece of music. I think it is apt to describe his use of the seventh here as one final raised eyebrow hanging over the eyeball of a C major. The eagle-eyed may notice something wrong about my transcriptions. There is only one drum part, even though in the version of the tune I transcribed, there were two drummers, Ralph Humphrey and Chester Thompson. The reason for this is that I transcribed Ralph's part from the last episode's version, where there is only Ralph. This is because I didn't need to transcribe both drum parts in order to communicate the full form of the composition. And I really like Ralph's playing from that version of the song, so I decided to look at it in more detail. I skimmed over the main melody a bit in this video, just because it wasn't really a part of the version I was looking at. I will be looking at it in more detail, along with Rollo Interior from St. Alfonso's Pancake Breakfast in the next video, which will focus on how Zappa constructs a melody. Also, let me know what you think about the format. I've tried to squeeze quite a lot of information into quite a small amount of time, so I wonder if this might have resulted in me focusing too much on description rather than explanation. I hope I've managed to strike some kind of balance between the what and the why. I'll leave links to the versions I analysed in the description, along with a link to some of my music, so do yourself a favour and listen to that.